Can we find that moment in the debate? I don't know if it's handy, but it should be. It's all over the place. Where Lester Holt asks Bernie about the socialism polling. You know what I'm talking about? This is exactly what Professor Wolff was talking about. While we find that, it was definitely in the last debate. It was Nevada debate, and Lester Holt asked him, "What do you think about, you know, basically the polls that show that most American, 2/3 of Americans don't want to vote for socialists?" And check out how Bernie responds. It should be clipped. While you're looking for that, in the last couple of minutes on the main show, and we have a lot to do on the post game, including we've gotten some leaked audio where Elizabeth Warren's campaign is now becoming a multi-level marketing plan that we're going to be playing for people. But can you give us, we're going to do some sort of ABCs of socialism with you over the next several times you're on. And starting now, can you give us a very basic introduction to the labor theory of value, which does track with what Bernie was hinting there in his exchange with Mini Mike?
Sure. Now?
Yeah, now, oh, go okay, for it. Well, we're looking, but please tell us.
Okay. To do this properly, you have to remember what modern economics is all about. It begins basically in the 18th century. There's some efforts before, but not much before, in the 18th century. And that's a period of time when Europe, which is where this starts, is going through a transition from feudalism to capitalism. And think of it this way. It's a little stylized, but summary. In feudalism, the economy is organized around the feudal manor, usually a small piece of land, a village, or maybe a group of villages.
Sent it to you, Matt.
Yeah, which have a kind of a basic problem. We produce dairy, we have cows, we grow crops, we make pots and pans and clothing. And so we could all do it for ourselves, be self-sufficient, and many villages had that. The individual family did all of it for itself. Or you could have rudimentary division of labor, people concentrating. This one's a baker, that one's a candlestick maker, and all the rest. And then you have the problem, how do you distribute what these people are making, since each one is producing kind of for everybody, and you have to have an arrangement. And in feudalism, it might be organized by the priest, or it might be organized by the feudal lord. But in the transition to capitalism, there's a transition to have the distribution of a division of labor accomplished in a quid pro quo exchange. I make bread. I'm going to be willing to give you a loaf, but you got to give me the shirt you make, because I don't want to be cold and I don't make shirts. I make bread. And so we get into this market arrangement where we bargain how many breads for the shirt, how many oranges for the chair, etc. Well, once you have a market, you have a whole new problem for the human mind, which is, wow, before, when I made everything myself here on the farm, I knew exactly how much labor, how much time I need to make my bread, how much time I need to sew my shirt, how much time I need to raise my pigs. But I don't know that anymore, because I'm now focused on one thing. I'm a pig farmer, or I'm a shoemaker, or whatever it is. And so my life doesn't depend only on how hard I work, which it used to when I was making everything. Now I depend on this thing called the market. I can make shoes just as well this year as I did last year, but when I go to the market to exchange them, they may fetch me no tomatoes instead of a bushel, which they did last year. Not because of anything I did in my work, not because of any change in my output, but because of a change in the market. This comes as a thunderbolt of mystery in human life, because we now have to understand not what we knew before, which is how much work and how much sweat it takes for me to raise the cow and raise the pigs and build the shack and all the rest, which I understood when my father and mother had taught me, etc. Now I have a new mystery, the mystery of the market, which poses itself as this fundamental question. Why are the prices of the things I buy and the things I sell what they are? I need to get some control over my life to have a theory of prices. Why do markets, why is the cell phone worth this and the book that and my pair of shoes the other? The mystery of them, and that's what people set themselves to produce. And the language they used was what explains the value of things when we trade them in the market. Not some intrinsic value, you know, what do you think about the thing? No, what does it get you when you come to market with X and you want Y? How's that work? What determines the ratio of X's for Y's? In the effort to understand that, theories were developed, a variety. If we had a lot of time, I'd take you through them. But I'm going to focus on the ones that became most important because they were invented, basically, by Adam Smith and David Ricardo, typically understood as the founders of modern economics. Both of them subscribed to, and this may shock some of your listeners, the labor theory of value. For those who think that Marx invented the labor theory of value, I have bad news. He didn't. Marx took the labor theory of value from Smith, who invented it, and from Ricardo, who modified it, and he modified it again. So it is correct that Marx had a labor theory of value, but it's a derivation, let's call it. It's an adjustment to what he learned from Smith and Ricardo. And he found it fascinating that they had linked the value of things in the market back to something more fundamental that caused that, namely, the, to use Adam Smith's language, the toil and trouble it takes to produce something. That has an important role to play in determining the value. How hard, how much work do you have to produce? So Marx did that. Adam Smith and Ricardo took the labor theory of value and used it to analyze capitalism as people who loved capitalism, who supported it, for whom they could enlighten the world about how wonderful capitalism was using the labor theory of value, which they did. Marx borrows from them, takes from them the labor theory of value, adjusts it, but what's important is he has a completely different goal and objective. He's using the labor theory of value to attack capitalism, to demonstrate why the human race can and should do better than capitalism. So yes, he borrows a tool, but no, it's not the same tool. But that isn't shouldn't surprise anyone because he was on a different trajectory. He had a different goal. His goal was the critique of capitalism and going further. Here's the irony that you may appreciate. Marx's interpretation, which is developed by him in the middle of the 19th century, toward the end of the 19th century, about 1870, it had become so widespread as the broad understanding that the labor theory of value got to be associated more with him than with its forms in Smith and Ricardo. And it made the people who thought about economics, still a small part of the population given literacy at that time and so on, it made them extremely nervous. And they said, my goodness, this labor theory of value, yeah, it was developed by Smith and Ricardo, and they love capitalism, but the guy who's running away with it is Marx, and he's using it as a battering ram against capitalism, in a way I'll show you in a couple of minutes. And so there was a reaction, and the reaction was, we've got to undercut Marx. The people who loved Smith and Ricardo, distraught at where Marx had kind of taken the labor theory of value, came to the conclusion, roughly at the same time in French, English, and German-speaking Europe, that the only way to defeat Marxism was to drop the labor theory of value. Even though they credited classical economics, Smith and Ricardo, for having developed it, they said, look, we love them, they are the founders, we share with them a love of capitalism, but you got to drop this labor theory of value because of what Marx has done with it. So they made their goal the development of an alternative theory of why prices are what they are in the market. The same old question. By the way, Marx did not go, that was not his question. He wasn't interested. I'm going to exaggerate. I mean, he did some work on the subject, but his main interest wasn't why prices go up. He was interested in how people relate to each other in society. He was a socialist. He wanted to change the relationships, not among things in a market, but among the people who buy and sell and work together. So he was interested in value theory because he wanted to look at how labor has to be reorganized to make a better society, which I'll get to. But the others didn't. They wanted to answer the question, why are prices what they are, without the labor theory of value. And what they did, the person in England who did it, Stanley Jevons, the person in French-speaking Europe, Leon Valras, as he's called, and in the German-speaking, Böhm Bawerk, hyphenated last name. And they all came up with what is now known as conventional mainstream economics, that value is determined by utility,
right,
not by labor. The thing is valuable not because of the labor taken to produce it, but by the usefulness people find in it. So this is a radical, now we've got nothing to do with labor. We're not interested in the reorganization of labor. Labor now becomes something that is passive, that is organized by the technology in play, and there's nothing more to say about it. You have the necessary workers who the machine says you need, and almost as kind of a technological determinism.
So this isn't, I just want to really underline this. This is not a technical innovation in a technical field. This ideological pivot. It in a political field.
That's okay. Right. 100%. Okay. So why? And it isn't that complicated. The reason the labor theory of value was junked and why modern economics is all about utility theory, which is what is taught in every university, in the United States at least, but in many parts of the world as well. It's modern economics. Because it held on to Smith and Ricardo, it was classical. But because it dropped the labor theory of value, it was different. So it called itself neoclassical, which is the tradition of economics that we have now. But that's the truth of what happened here. Okay, so here's Marx's idea. When anything is produced, the producer, the capitalist in a capitalist system, buys a certain amount of inputs, machines, tools, raw materials, and they have whatever value they have. They cost him something. And when they get used up in production to produce something else, the value in them is transferred to the output made by using them up. But of course, let's use the example of a ladder. If you buy wood and glue and hammers and all the things you need to make a ladder, the value of the ladder at the end is greater than the value of the inputs that go in. And the difference is the value added by the laborer, the human being who uses the hammer and the nails to shape the wood into a ladder, thereby makes the ladder more valuable because of the labor added. To Marx, this is the labor theory of value. It took a bunch of labor to make the inputs. That the value or that labor gets transferred to the output. But to that is added in the production process, the living labor, he calls it, the human being using his or her brains and muscle. And now Marx makes a simple observation on which everything else sits. He says, when the worker works, this living laborer, he adds more value than he is paid for doing the work. The capitalist gets a difference. The difference being, I'm going to pay you X, but when you work, you're going to add more than X to what you produce. And the more than X, I will realize when I sell the output. Because the way capitalism works is you come to work, you pour your brains and muscles into this product. But as the product is produced, you have no claim on it. Your claim is the wages I will pay you. What the value is that you've produced that I have the right to sell is none of your business. But the capitalist knows that his well-being is to create the biggest difference possible between the value added by the worker, which is given by the worker's effort, and the value paid to him, and that's a negotiated deal between employer and employee. And the reason that employers are always trying to cut what they give to workers one way or another is not about their greedy or nasty or unfeeling people. It is the way the system works. If you're successful at it, you'll have a profit, and that will allow you to grow and survive. And if you're not successful at it, you will die because you'll be outcompeted by others who are. So you have to abuse your workers every chance you get. Take away their bathroom privileges. Take away their parking facility. Find a way to speed up their activity. Do everything you can to maximize the difference between the work they do, whose value is added to your output, and what you pay them. And that contradiction between the workers, who have no incentive to work harder because the fruits of that go to the other guy.
Right.
And he, who has no reason to be compassionate with them because it interferes in his success to be compassionate. Oh, go to the toilet, take an extra 10 minutes. I mean, what? He can't do that. And that's not because he's mean or nasty. That's the way the system works. And the conclusion for Marx is, don't yell at the worker and don't yell at the employer. These are people lost in a relationship that has to change. Only then is it reasonable to ask, to demand of them the moral behavior, because otherwise you're asking them to be moral while the system in which they are surviving requires them to ignore your advice. And instead of being frustrated, understand capitalism is the problem.
That's a perfect way to transition to the postgame. I'm going to leave it on that note. That's perfect. You just watched a Michael Brooks Show video. Subscribe to get them all. Why wouldn't you? Don't be foolish. Click subscribe below and become a patron as well. Patreon.com/TMBS. Thanks, everybody.